today the four of us, that is Malaika, Jeewaka, myself and Saman, would like to speak to you and share our experience of fatherhood. And to begin, Malaika, would you share about your father and your experiences?
When I look back on my childhood with my dad, there are many things that come to mind, many fond memories. One thing that I remember, my dad, as most dads are, he was a busy man, he was a hard-working man, but he always, always made time for me. And see, I love bookshops, and I even up to today, I love hanging out in a bookshop or in a library or wherever there are books. And my father was, however busy he was, when he took me to a bookshop, which was quite often, he never rushed me. He never said, hurry up, he never said, come soon. But he always gave me time, and I was able to spend lots of time in bookshops. He just made that time for me. Another thing, of course, my dad taught me much. He taught me so much. But just to recount one thing, he taught me not to give up, and he taught me to reach higher, to not give up, basically. And just an incident that illustrates that, when I was about 7 or 8, we were climbing sea area, and when I reached halfway point, I was exhausted, and I was just ready to give up, and I wanted to turn back. But my dad didn't allow me to. He coaxed me and encouraged me and said, no, we can reach the summit. And we did. So,
I guess one thing that all of us have in common is we can say that we all have hardworking fathers. They're probably busy working and taking care of things so that we can have the life that we deserve to have. My father was pretty much busy most of the time, and it was my mother who was there at home. The only time I guess we would probably get to spend time with him is when we were on school holidays, and I would tag along with him whenever he went to his Kausha Chase, where he would teach me the do's and don'ts. And I guess throughout my childhood, that's the relationship that I had with my father. So I got closer, I guess the relationship with myself and my father got closer when he dropped me off in uni. So he settled me down, went to the airport, I dropped him at the airport. Us both being men, we hugged it out, and he said, you know, just patted me on the back and just left. I've never said this story before up until this morning. I went back to my room. It was scary. I was terrified, actually, living with a bunch of random people. And I just bawled. I was crying and crying all night. And then I got a call the next day from my mother. She said, guess what happened? Your Sati called me last night, and he was bawling in the airport. And a part of me was kind of happy because I was doing that alone. But that's one experience and memory that I will cherish forever.
For me, I think growing up, it was quite different, Jeewaka, because I actually grew up without a father. The only recollection I have of my father was he made something out of meccano, and that was moving around, and I remember this very distinctly. Because I was 2 when I lost my father. So most of the time when people ask me what is it not to have a father, few years ago I would have said, you know, I couldn't know, because I have not actually experienced a father to know what I have lost. But today, when I look back, what I see is that God the Father took that place, and actually it was not that I had not experienced it, but He ensured that that void was not there in my life. And other than when you went to school and on the first day of the term, or you know, as you start school, teachers have a habit of getting each person to say, what did your father do? And that used to be the most difficult thing for me, because what do I say? Do I say what he did before, or do I say that my father is not alive? So this is always a challenge for me. But other than that, I can tell you that God the Father had taken the place of my father.
I do have a testimony to relate to you. A testimony that happened almost 39 years. A horrific experience where I almost lost my three fingers. On this fateful day, my father's doctor was a doctor by profession. So we used to go to this place in Masala where he had his practice. This fateful Sunday, he took me and I would tag along with him anytime because the little time that I would have with him, I would either play chess or cricket with him, so which I treasured very much. I was in grade 2, I remember, so I tagged along and then he told me very specifically that this Sunday is going to be some work outside and it's going to be some dangerous work. So he locked me inside. He didn't realize that I could use my little hand and open the door and come out anytime. So I came out to see they were straightening these coconut trees using steel cables. Actually, a coconut tree can be straightened maybe 8 to 10 feet by using these cables. So I watched this and then I also wanted to help out. So the place that I could touch the wire was the at the base of the stump where the other tree was already being pulled. So I went and did my part. I was pulling as well behind the tree. Nobody saw me. And suddenly they have done their job and they let the pulley go. My three fingers were caught between the coconut tree and the steel wire. And now I could see my wounds open and then, you know, flesh tearing up and then blood oozing out. I didn't say anything, I didn't cry, I couldn't move. So the man came and said, "Baby, you're getting angry." So he just said that I can't move because my fingers are caught. So then my father came and saw this and then he was really scared. I could see that on his face. So there were a lot of advice given to him all at once. He first said, cut the cable. He said, no. He said, cable ka kapot, make what a deal up that I'll lose my three fingers. So he actually prayed to the Holy Spirit and he asked for wisdom. And then he got this wise thought that, you know, people should hang on the steel cable. So he got all the people to hang on the steel cable to let loose my hand. So I think after about 30 or 40 people come out, I was able to take the fingers out and I could literally see the three bones. So I was, this is a horrific experience that would have changed my entire life. My cricket career, my sports, everything would have gone. So I am ever grateful to my earthly father for taking that spontaneous decision in consultation with my heavenly father. So this is the testimony that I want to share. Thank you.
Me and my family was a bit different. When we were born and raised Buddhist, all of us, I guess, at some point have, it's different. I can honestly say that with the presence of the Lord around each other and around your house, I don't know how to explain it, but it's much better. And everyone goes through ups and downs in life. And a few years ago, we all went through a down and a valley, which affected my father and all of us equally. And I saw it affected him even though he tried to hide it as much as he could. I saw a huge change in him as he got closer to the Lord and his walk with the Lord became closer. I saw a huge change in him in ways I could never imagine. He changed the way he thought, the way he did things. He was more calmer. It was a huge change and that actually motivated me to get closer with my walk with the Lord. I just want to take this opportunity to thank God for coming into our lives and secondly and most importantly for blessing me with such a wonderful giving father.
Jeewaka, when you were talking about getting closer to your dad only during your university years, I remember growing up, my dad and I were very, we loved each other and we enjoyed spending time together. But I think in my teenage years, I mean, as a young adult, we never really had heart-to-heart chats or deep conversations about anything much, I suppose mainly because he thought of me still as a little girl. But I remember one thing, one very distinct memory. memory that I have is on my wedding day, on our wedding day. Usually it's customary for the bridesmaid to help the bride out of the car when she comes to the church. But my dad had given strict instructions to my bridesmaid, I will help her out of the car. And that's what he did. When we arrived at the church, he helped me out, veil and all. He was the one who helped me out of the car. And I sort of look at that incident as maybe one last gesture of helping me out and being there for me before he gave me marriage. Having said that, now my relationship with my dad, after being married with two children of my own, my relationship with my dad has changed. It has matured, it has deepened, and now the conversations we have, the chats we have on the phone when we meet, he has given me so much of insight into different areas of my life. He's dropped so many valuable nuggets of wisdom into my life, and I just treasure that relationship that I have with my dad now, which I think is much, much deeper than anything I had before as a child.
When I think of my relationship with my children, as a young father, I just remember a few years ago, that is in 2010, when my eldest daughter was born. Now, I was never a person who was, I was not very fond of babies. Now, my wife on the other hand was very fond of babies, and she used to say, look at this baby, isn't she beautiful? And deep down inside me, I would think, what's the beauty she sees in this? I couldn't understand this. Anyway, we were going to have this baby, and it didn't strike, we were going to have a baby, but it didn't strike me that much. But I still remember when she was born, and one of my wife's friends also was there, she was a doctor, she was beside us, and she said, why don't you go and take a photograph? So I took my camera and I went, because she was on something like a tray, I don't know what to call it, but some sort of like a tray, and she was there, and I took the camera and I went to click, and this little one looked at me and I looked at her and our eyes met, and that's actually when I fell in love with her. And I can tell you that the relationship and my understanding changed completely. And today, everything, the love for our children, it's something deeper. It's the sacrificial love that we have for the little ones. And we tend to, you do anything for them. And that's basically what our lives have turned out to be. And fatherhood has changed me as a person as well, because placing the children always first and doing everything for them, not only to look at the current, but also to look to the future. And that's something that that has played a part in my life.
Today is a great day, we celebrate Father's Day. So, looking back at my life and looking forward towards my children, I was thinking what is it that I could learn, I could share with you. When you think back, things have not changed much. Children want basically one thing. So if you guys, your fathers out there, if you ask yourself, what is the greatest gift that you can offer your children? I think it's your time. There's nothing else to match that. Because if you spend time with your children, that is the greatest thing that they will treasure. So, with these words, we wish you all a happy Father's Day, a blessed Father's Day. May you take some message from our testimonies. Thank you.